Praise God. Amen. Would you join me today? Certainly, happy Father's Day to all the fathers in the house today. And last Sunday, we started on a series of sermons dealing with fathers and men. If you would join me today in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, and we will look at verse 26. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And when you have found it, I ask that you would stand and join me this morning as we hear from God. Genesis 1, verse 26. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And this was on the sixth day of creation. On the sixth day of creation. Hear now the words that are recorded by the writer of the book of Genesis. And God said, let us make man in our image. Amen. May the Lord bless the reading and the hearing of his holy word. Let the people of God say together, amen. 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 Y'all looking at me like, huh? Amen. Amen. In Genesis, and praise God, chapter 1, amen, verse 26, and we call it the writer recorded what God said. God said, let us make man in our image. Amen. I would like today on Father's Day, and the brothers told me, don't beat him up too bad today. Amen. So I need some help today. Amen. I would like to preach on this thought, fathers in the image of God. Amen. Fathers in the image of God. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, we need some fathers that are in the image of God. Amen. Come on, brother. We can say it louder than that. Say, neighbor, we need some fathers that are in the image of God. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Fathers in the image of God. The Bible teaches us that God created men on the sixth day in the image of himself. In God's likeness, men were created. The word likeness means portrait or copy. It means being similar. It means just like. It means that we should be a picture of God. So on the sixth day, when God created man, he made man as a portrait, as a copy, as something similar to himself when he created us men. He created us in his image. That's just like when you have a child and your child comes out looking just like you. He is a copy. He is a portrait, or she is a portrait or a copy of who you are. And if God, who is the Father of creation, made us in the image of himself, that means, men, that all of the father-like qualities of God were put inside of us. If we were made in the image of God, the Father of all creation, that means that everything that was inside of God that was father-like was put inside of us when he made us from the dirt of the earth. And the Bible says here, that means that the qualities of God, the faithfulness of God as a father was put inside of me when God created me and God made me in God's own image. God's unconditional love for all of us was put inside of me when God made me in God's image. When God put Adam in the Garden of Eden, God ordained Adam to be the father of his earthly creation. As the father of the Garden of Eden, God gave Adam three things. He gave him relationship. Adam was in relationship with God. He gave him authority and dominion, number two. And then finally, he gave him responsibility. His responsibility was to take care of what God had created. Amen. So he gave him relationship with him. He gave him authority, power to rule, to have dominion over what he had created. And then he gave him responsibility. You are responsible responsible for taking care of what I made. But what does that mean for us today, fathers? What does it mean to be created and made in the image of God? What kind of fathers does God want us to be? What does he want me to be today in 2013? What kind of father? In the book of Jeremiah chapter 17, the prophet said, Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. God wants us to be men that trust in God. Amen. He doesn't want us to trust in anything else, but he wants us to trust in God. Because when we trust in God, we bring blessings upon ourselves. Well, why has my life gotten better over the years? I believe because I have learned in my life to trust in God. Even when things were not going well, I still trusted in God. We can't trust in anything else but God. We can put our faith in other stuff, but let me tell you, it will disappoint you in the long run. You gotta put your faith and your trust in God. Everything else in life that you accumulate won't last. All the stuff that I have done in this community, when I die, somebody's gonna forget about it along the way. But if I put my trust in God, if I trust in God and walk with God as a man of God, created in the image of God, then God will bless me, and God will keep me, and God will shield me, and God will protect me. God wants me to be a godly man. He wants me to be a godly father. He wants me to walk in obedience to God's divine word. I just can't be a church man. I got to be a godly man. Well, why is that important? Why is it important? Why is it important, fathers, for us to be in the image of God as fathers? Number one, godly fathers, praise God, I like this. I was, the other day I was going down, and this really disturbed me. I was going down Harding Street. I was going down Harding Street. It was a Thursday night. I was driving down Harding Street, and I seen a bunch of young boys playing. It was about 12 of them. And them boys couldn't have been no more than somewhere between 8 and 13 years old, even if that old. And I was watching the boys play. And as I was watching the boys play, there was one boy about 10 years old. He had something in his hand. And as I got closer, I noticed that he had a pistol in his hand. Here he was, this boy was no more than about 10 years old. He was playing, but he had a pistol in his hand. And I began to think about that, because in the book of Exodus, in chapter 20, when it gives the Ten Commandments, it says this, fathers, that the sins of the fathers shall be passed down to the third and the fourth generations. And I began to think about this boy. This boy had a pistol in his hand. I remember talking to Daryl Brother, group of OGs in the church, and I started talking to him. And one of the OGs said to me, he said, Pastor, I've been in and out of prison for 30 years. And he said to me, I got two sons, praise God, who are now in prison. It wasn't my intent for my sons to go to prison, but my sons ended up doing what I didn't want them to do. See, what he began to understand was, because of how he lived his life, he brought a curse upon his sons. And if you don't know how to break the curse, then your sons and your daughters may end up just like you. I bet you that boy's father, whoever he is, might have been somebody that might have been carrying a pistol himself at some point in his life. Well, why is it important for us to know God? Because if we know God as men, if God becomes important to us as men, then God becomes important to our sons and our daughters. We send a message to our boys that God is important. But if we don't put God first, we can't expect our children to put God first. And then we can't break the curses that are on their lives because we don't put God first. I was determined not to be like my daddy. My daddy went to prison. But how do I pray? Number one, men, if you're going to be in the image of God and you're going to be a godly father, you got to live in the Word. You got to live in the Word. Jesus said in Matthew 4, verse 4, it is written, men, that it is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Godly fathers know that the most important thing in life is God. That's what godly fathers make. The most important thing in life is what? It is God. See, you understand, as you get older, you start understanding some stuff. That all that stuff that you did when you was younger didn't mean anything. And it doesn't even matter. I don't care how popular you may come or how much money you may earn in life. Let me tell you this. One day, you're going to have to bow down to God. Amen. One day, you're going to have to bow down to God. Because I have buried hundreds of people since I've been a pastor. But let me tell you something. When they roll you down front and put you in the casket, amen, they might put a checkbook in there, but you won't be able to use it. If they put your credit cards and all your gold and silver in the casket, you won't be able to use it. And if enough people know that it's in there, they might dig you up again. Come on, ladies, I need your help, because the men ain't going to say nothing today. Amen. I need your help today. Amen. God has to be important. The most important thing in your life. See, it's nothing. Listen, brothers, I keep telling you that it is nothing wrong with making God important in our life. It's nothing wrong with making God the most important thing in your life. And here's what I discovered. You can put God first and still enjoy life. Amen. You can put God first and still enjoy life. Amen. Being a Christian, no, it's not. To put God first in your life, there's nothing boring about that. And watch this. You don't have to chase when you put God first. Amen. You don't have to run after something if you put God first. Amen. Because if you put God first, God will put you first. Send you someone that is your heart's desire, so that you don't have to chase more than one. Oh, I didn't get no amens on that. Happy out, sister. Valerie told me, she said, Pastor, you may need some help getting out of here today. Amen. Number two, fathers. Because I'm going somewhere with this. We are called to be spiritual leaders. Amen. Remember what he gave Adam? He gave him relationship. We lead by godly example. We lead by godly example. Amen. We exercise spiritual authority. We make good spiritual judgments. Amen. We teach our children self-control. Come here, Jeremiah. Come here for a second. Amen. Amen. I have to teach him by example. Now, if he sees me treating his mama right, come on, y'all gotta watch this. If he sees me treating his mama right, then he's gonna know how to treat a woman. Why? Because his daddy was an example. Amen. Now, I just don't send him to church with his mama. I bring him to church because I want him to know now that God is important. Now, what I'm teaching him now is to try to control your temper, because you can't get mad and strike out. I tell him all the time, watch your daddy. Your daddy doesn't get mad and strike out. You gotta learn how to control. Praise God. Praise God. Y'all got me sweating up here, y'all. And fathers, we are called to be good family men. Number three, and here's what the Bible says in Ephesians 5:25, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, amen. And to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. It talks about how we ought to deal with our wives. We ought to love our wives as Christ loves the church. And he wants the best for his wife, amen. And then he presented her as spotless and blameless before God. And then fathers, here's the big one. In Ephesians 6:4, it says, fathers, do not provoke your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Now listen, you might not like your child's mama. Y'all got to catch this now. But that's irrelevant. Because you liked that one time, that's the reason you got that baby. Come on now, amen. Now you got to put your child about how you feel about that woman. Because your responsibility is to that child. And when you neglect your child, you provoke your child. Most of these young men out here that we deal with in the streets are angry because their daddies are not in their lives. And when you don't spend any time with your boys and your girls, you provoke them to do something wrong because you are mad at mama. Well, you shouldn't have had the baby if you don't want to be the father. Oh, shoot. Let me come over here with you, Tim. Amen. Come here, look cool over there, but over there. You know, amen. Come on, ladies. I need your help today. Amen. Listen. If this is true, what would happen if men put God first? Brother Thomas, come here. Come here. Praise God. Daryl, come here. Anthony, come here. Praise God. Kenny, come on, whole boy. Eric, come here. Come here. James, come here. Come here, brothers. Come here. What would happen? What would happen? Line across the church and face the church. Come here, brothers. Come here. What would happen? What would happen? What would happen if godly men, praise God, godly men, praise God, started to put God first. Here's what would happen. Even though you're not with your son's mother and she's not going to church, because that's your son and you got a daughter, every Sunday morning you got a responsibility. What was your responsibility? Your responsibility is to be in relationship with God. Number one is to have authority and dominion. Number two, and then number three is to take care of. Amen. Your responsibility is to take care of your children spiritually, so that even though you're not with them anymore, you're going to take care of them. So they're not going to church. So every Sunday morning, you pick up your children and you bring your sons and your daughters to church with you. Now, what would happen if fathers started doing it God's way? If we started being godly fathers and started bringing our sons to church? Here's what I'm going to tell you what would happen. Your boy. boys who are gangbangers, shooting up the neighborhood and terrorizing the neighborhood. If fathers would show them the right way, you would have to worry about walking through your neighborhood, worrying about somebody knocking you upside the head or robbing you. If you were a godly father and you did it God's way, because the Bible says in 2 Chronicles, oh praise God, chapter 7, verse 14, in my people, he's talking about the men. If the men would humble themselves, if the men would get on their knees, if the men would seek God's face, if the men would put God first, if the men would turn from their wicked ways, if the men would turn from their sin, if the men would lead by example, then I hear from heaven, and then I heal the land. The man's not going to get healed until the fathers get it right. And if we get it right, our sons are getting it right. Then our daughters are getting it right. They won't marry every thug that says hello to them. If daddy is so right, if daddy was so what a good man looks like, better than a thug knocking on your door. I'm not trying to take your daughter, but men, we gotta get it right. Leadership, relationship, we got to get it right, and if we get it right, then the black community will change. If we get it right, we won't be hearing on channel 13 and channel 8 and channel 6 and 59 about another brother shooting another brother. If the brothers get it right, if the daddies get it right. Because if your children are going right, and my children are going right, and our family's doing it right, then it starts affecting other children. Brothers, and I ain't slamming nothing y'all doing in the church, but we got to do more to have a once a month meeting. Come on, God said amen, but I'm going to say it for you. Because we got to do more than just meet in this church and fellowship among one another. Listen, last night on Annette and Eugene was about 20 boys hanging out on that corner. Down on the next corner of Eugene was a large number of young adult men just hanging out. Now what if us godly men, some of the old G's who God has turned your life around, what if you took your story on the corner where those boys are hanging out who are mad because their daddy's not in their life, but you became a father figure to them? What would happen? I bet you them boys would be hanging out on Eugene Street every day and selling drugs and getting into criminal activity if us men started caring about them. I can't do it by myself, y'all. Let's pray. God, I'm excited about many of these godly fathers in the church. But God, there's too many men that are not like them. There's too many girls and boys who are suffering because their biological father is not living in the image of his heavenly father. So God, a few of us men now this church are praying for all of the men. And our prayer is, God, some men who care, some fathers who care, will take it upon themselves to try to make a difference in some other young lady or young man's life. And where they don't have the biological father in their life, I pray, God, that you would raise an army of men who will begin to be fathers and grandfathers to many of these young men and young ladies who don't have daddy in their life. And then, God, for those of us fathers who have children, God, help us to remember that it is an honor to be created in your image. So help us, God, to be godly husbands and godly fathers to our children and spiritual leaders in our community. This is our prayer. As you are praying right now, there might be somebody in here today who does not have a relationship with their Heavenly Father. And if you don't know Christ for yourself, I shared with you, I've been doing this a long time, since I was 17. And my life has gotten better and better. And I want to say to you, if you want your life to go in the right direction and be blessed by God, make the decision today to make Jesus Lord of your life. So I now open up the doors to the kingdom. If there's someone here who wants to make Jesus Lord of their life, you may not want to walk down, but if you just raise your hand, one of the fathers in the church, one of the ministers will meet you just right where you are. There may be somebody else. You are already in the right relationship with Christ, but you would like to become a part of this church family. We invite you to come. And if you don't want to come, just raise your hand. And then there may be a third person. You desire baptism, or you want to recommit your life back to Christ. We invite you also to come. Is there one? Because you were made in the image of God. So take your authority. Take your responsibility. And stay in the right relationship with Him. And God will continue to bless your life. Is there one?